We are really delighted to have Robert Goolrick with us at Politics and Prose tonight. I was sure we had had him before, and I went back through our event archives, and I was astounded that we had not and felt horrible that we hadn't. So we're really thrilled to have you for this book. We hope this is the beginning of a trend and that you'll come back for all your next books. Tonight, of course, he'll be talking about his new novel. It's called The Fall of Princes, along with a highly acclaimed memoir. He's written two previous novels, one of which I think most of you know was a New York Times bestseller, and this is his fourth book. In The Fall of Princes, Mr. Goolrick takes readers on a deep dive into the underbelly of Wall Street, the greed and excess that became signatures of the wealthy titans and wannabes of New York finance in the latter part of the 20th century. I was thinking about this earlier today. This is actually a very tricky subject for a writer because it can so easily devolve into caricature. But Mr. Goolrick has a keen ability to capture the ethos of self-absorption and decadence of the high-flying New York financiers of the 1980s. He has an eye for the comedic, the tragic, and the tension that sometimes exists between the two. In telling the story of one Wall Street prince's rise and fall, Mr. Goolrick isn't satisfied with the obvious, the sex and drugs and alcohol and lavish and outlandish spending. He also explores the collateral issues of sexuality, the marginalization of women, and even AIDS. Readers not only will be enthused by his writing, but also compelled by the morality tale that is his protagonist's life represents. Once an advertising man in New York himself, and that perhaps explains his visceral understanding of the world he writes about, Mr. Goolrick now has a more peaceful life, I think I can say that, in Virginia with his dog Preacher. A Washington Post review said of The Fall of Princes, Goolrick writes with an immediacy and precision that make this world feel as if it is all his own. He is greatly aided in this by a finely tuned sense of bleak humor. We are delighted to have you here tonight, and thank you all for joining us. Please welcome Robert Goolrick to Politics and Prose.
First of all, let me say that I'm honored to be here at Politics and Prose. It is an enormously great bookstore. It's a legend. And any city that has a bookstore, an independent bookstore as great as this one, is honored to have it. And you must support it with all your strength, because to lose it would be a terrible, terrible thing. And I say this at independent bookstores all over the country. They are the lifeblood of literature in this country. And we would be nothing without them, writers. We would be nothing. And this book, just to give you a little hint, it's okay to laugh once in a while. It's about a time long ago and far away when we were all very young and very foolish, the 80s. And in the acknowledgments, it says that I wrote the book for the sweethearts and darlings of my youth. And It is essentially, and this is a secret, it is essentially a love letter to the woman who got away. And this chapter is called One Reason I Don't Go to the Beach Anymore. More than a decade ago, a lifetime ago really, I rented a lovely summer house by the sea, not exactly by the sea, but close enough. And it had a big pool and five bedrooms and a sunroom and an English box garden, and you could see the ocean from a widow's walk on the roof. It was owned by these two interior decorators, so everything was just so, and it was all kind of perfectly done in an English country house kind of way and filled with light and shadow. It was everything my apartment in town wasn't, and it was just swell. It was like being in an episode of Masterpiece Theater. All you needed was an under housemaid arranging flowers in cut glass vases. This was just as the great tailgate party was coming to an end, and I had an almost infinite amount of money, or so it seemed. I worked on the street, and while I didn't particularly enjoy helping rich people shift money around every minute of every day so that they could get even richer at the expense of people who had no money and never would have, I was racked with guilt at the same time. I was insane with adrenaline and raging testosterone. Still, the money was fantastic, and the roll, the flow of it was like mainlining every day. The roll smelled like money. You could feel the poison boiling through your veins. Money was the big news, the lifeblood of the decade, and I was in it up to my elbows. I worked in a big room that was basically like a casino. There were no windows, no clocks, nothing but the relentless flicker of financial news on dozens of TV sets. It was both timeless and relentless. The days were vicious, but the nights were filled with fat stogies in the cigar room at Frank's and big steaks, and then on to clubs where we swaggered in our monogrammed Sea Island cotton shirts and $200 scarf ties from Hermes and sat in the VIP section and ran up $2,000 bar bills and took town cars home at 3 in the morning when we had to be back at the office at 7:30. We did things like write our phone numbers on girls' tits with Mont Blanc pens, and they always called us back, always. You could smoke them. That's how long ago it was. This was life. This was everyday life, and we didn't understand people who didn't live like this. We were the pulse, the heartbeat of the decade, and we were all young and mostly good-looking, and we all found time to work out like dogs, weird times like 6 in the morning, so we had these fantastic bodies. Well, not all of us had fantastic bodies. Some had the spindly, hollow-eyed stares of junkies, and some topped 300 pounds and smoked 3 packs of cigarettes a day, but I'm thinking about the guys who came to the house that summer. We were all in perfect shape and had the kind of women you get when you have a fantastic body and a wad of cash and the utter arrogance that comes with having the big dog on the leash. We were the people wrote about when they wrote about the evils of contemporary society. We made too much money, we spent too much money, we didn't do a single thing to help the less fortunate, which included most of the people on the planet. We drank too much, we did too many drugs. We had 18-year-old kids with Rasta braids coming to drop shit off in the middle of the day. We went to Alphabet City the minute we got into our black town cars at the end of a stressful day. We felt not 1 ounce of remorse. We only felt pity for the rest of the gray masses. All of those things were true, but man, did we have fun. It was like a giant testosterone flambé. Bonuses were a big thing. Bonuses were given out around Christmas time in yards, a yard being $1 million. People would say, sucking on a big fat Cubano, that they got a yard or a yard and a half. Everybody lied, of course, but everybody got a lot, and it was a big deal. I wasn't necessarily the brightest nickel in the bag, but I had the best education, and I was aggressive as a pit bull. I could trade shit for silk, and so I was good for half a yard at least. I was 31. After I paid off the taxes and my enormous bills, I owed Bergdorf's $12,000, which was basically 3 suits, 2 cashmere sweaters, and a bottle of Acqua di Parma, the same cologne Cary Grant wore. I still had quite a pile, and I decided to get my own house in the Hamptons, not just any house, the house. I had shared before little bungalows on Gin Lane. I had gone through the ritual of being a house guest. My mother once said, when you're a house guest, don't ring the doorbell with anything but your elbow. So I took cases of champagne and new badminton sets from Hammacher Schlemmer. So I knew what I wanted was a palace of my own where I could invite people every weekend and have them bring me lavish and largely unusable stuff. I looked at 6 houses. I took the 6th one. It was chintzed and striped and leopard printed, stuff that would charm women, and it had a grand piano and a deck from which you could smell the sea and the pool and the garden and service for 30. It was English aristocracy without the dog shit and the cigarette burns in the upholstery. Someone witty once said to me that living in a castle wasn't all it was cracked up to be. Darling, she said, you still have to wash your hair in the bathtub. I had never been in an English country house. I thought this was the real thing. I rented it immediately. It cost $96,000, Memorial Day to Labor Day, and I wrote a check. The house came with a maid so the owners could feel safe about their fabulous stuff, and she cost another $800 a week, which I also paid by check. And I leased a car for the summer, a deeply impressive convertible Mercedes, midnight black, with every accoutrement you could think you could wish for, and the smell of brand new leather, and a top that slid back with the touch of a button, slid back as silently as a snake through the grass. This was a very nice car. I gave them my platinum card. I bought sheets in the city for every bedroom, from Frette, since the sheets were the kind of clever pastiche designed to make you think maybe Kmart was a good idea after all. My guests would sleep in 1,000-thread cotton, white with scallop borders, so the cool night air could pass over their bodies like a lover's kiss. I still have the sheets. Quality lasts. I found a huge Moroccan tent in the city and bought it for $25,000 and had it put up on the lawn and filled with benches and silk pillows and those low kind of Moroccan tables and hung with chandeliers. So it was like being in a fancy seraglio all about sex. It was hot as hell in there, like being at a rinky-dink circus on a July afternoon in Reno, Nevada. But it was lavishly and painstakingly embroidered and dotted with thousands of tiny little mirrors, and it was painstakingly beautiful. From the second story of the house, you look down at the roof of it, or whatever tents have, and it was like looking down at the stars with all the mirrors twinkling and the candles glowing softly through the canvas. The first weekend, I invited my main buddies from the firm, George, who was hysterical, and Frank, who was enormous, 6'4", just to show I wasn't filled with self-doubt, and Finelli and Trotmeyer. I took 2 days off from work to stock the house, bread and desserts from the Barefoot Contessa, $30 a pound lobster salad from Loaves and Fishes, and all kinds of salads and hors d'oeuvres and candy and cakes from all over, and vegetables from the Green Thumb and liquor, Jesus, everything you could imagine. I even stopped by the road and bought tall flowers to go in all those vases and little bunches in every room. And when I was done, the whole thing looked like an at-home Vogue shoot showing how English heiresses lived when they were tired of town and longed for the simple country life. Friday night, they all showed up with the girls, and I picked Carmela up from the jitney, and we were a household. The girls, frankly, were the least of it. Everybody assumed they would be beautiful and pliable and enviable and basically disposable. So all summer, the house was the five guys and whatever the cat dragged in. And the presents, like Christmas all over again. George brought a case of 1966 Romani Conti Montrachet, God knows where he found it, and Frank bought a picnic hamper from Bergdorf's with real china plates, and Finelli, who was a thug, bought a Z of really good Coke, and Trotmeyer brought 10 white beach towels with my initials on them, every monogram a different color. We drank rum drinks that came out of a blender. Frank claimed he'd never seen a blender before, and Trotmeyer said he'd never tasted rum. His mother told him it was the devil's drink, taught him never to touch it. He got over that pretty fast. And Frank became a whiz master at making blended drinks because he was mechanically inclined, he said. The household was perfect. It was a complete universe all by itself. We ate butterflied leg of lamb on the Weber grill, and we drank rum and Montrachet until we were silly, and did many, many lines of fine white cocaine, but only after we'd eaten the lamb and this $90 a bottle of Burgundy I had laid in. And we smoked Cuban cigars until the whole angst of the week had worn away, and we went to bed at 2 a.m. to sleep with these beautiful girls, and the sex was not quiet, and every form of human sensuality was redolent in the quiet night air. The next morning by 11, everybody was fresh as a daisy. Juices were poured, omelets got made and eaten out on the sun porch, and then Bloody Marys got made and drunk out by the pool. And then the guys went off to play tennis. We knew this one guy, a yard and a half at least, who had hired a tennis pro for the summer to come every Saturday afternoon. So we got to going over there and knocking balls around while the women looked on and read novels. Us quick-footed in our $300 Prada tennis shorts and our raggedy old t-shirts from Joe's Stone Crab in Miami, Florida, and places like that just to show we weren't fashion pussies. We were the kind of people who got their pictures in Hampton's magazine. We were the kind of people who dressed in Nantucket red linen trousers to go to the Hamptons Classic Horse Show. We could get into Nick and Tony's, impossible to get into on 30 minutes notice. That kind of people. The second weekend, we found the perfect thing to round out the house. We found a pet. Her name was Julia de Bosset. She was European. I found her at a party. She came up to me at a bar while I was getting more drinks for everybody, and she looked straight at me and she said, "I know you," as though we were in the middle of some conversation already. "I'm sorry, I don't." "What?" "I know you. I met you while you were still at Hopkins. I was just a little girl." It turned out she was the baby sister of the college roommate of this extremely thin girl I used to date. We called her the Pencil. And so we rehashed old times, and I asked her where she was staying, and she said she was staying at the godforsaken Maidstone Club, of all places. Her father was a member, as was his father and grandfather, with all these old farts. So I asked her to come stay with us, where at least she could get some peace and quiet without somebody whacking golf balls all over the place all the time. Things were different then. We spit at golf. So she came. She picked up her things at 2 a.m, and she came and slept in the little maid's room off the kitchen, which she said was just fine with her anywhere but that mausoleum. She was a waif. She was like Audrey Hepburn. Not that I knew who Audrey Hepburn was at the time. That was just one piece of information that hadn't been downloaded yet. Later, I kept hearing her name, especially when she died. So I rented and I went and rented all these old movies. And boy, she was something. And boy, was she ever like Julia de Beausset. I bet neither one of them ever went to a dance where they had to get their hands stamped if they wanted to get back in. Julia was a native, was naive and quiet, and had chopped off hair and lived in the East Village where nobody lived in those days. And she would tell funny stories about finding guys shooting up on her stairs. And she talked about getting mugged by the same guys, and she obviously had money. And we were all intrigued, and we just adored her, and so we asked her back, and she came. She came every weekend, and she slept in the little maid's room off the kitchen. I went back to Frette and got sheets for her too, so she wouldn't feel bad about staying in the single bed in a little room that barely had a bathroom. Her sheets were very fancy, embroidered with vines and periwinkle blue, so her room would seem special in some way. She wasn't as pretty as the other girls. She wasn't athletic. She didn't like to lie in the sun. She was slim as a reed and had flawless skin, and boy, could she make a great Greek salad. Give her a lemon, some really good olive oil, some mustard, some garlic, and some kosher sea salt, and she could really make a salad into a whole new thing. It took her a long time to do it, but it was worth every second. She had no interest in sex, and believe me, we tried. Even Trotmeyer tried, and he was very fastidious. She said she was a virgin and she had kind of a quietude, as though she weren't even waiting for something and anything that had happened was just fine with her. She'd show up every weekend. We offered to drive her, but she said she liked the jitney. She liked getting the free water and looking at all the faces, not looking at one another, and she'd show up at sunset with an overstuffed vintage Vuitton satchel, and out of that bag would come the most fantastic clothes, some all spangled and beaded, some of the kind you'd wear to the Queen's garden party, not that we knew what you'd actually wear to such an event, but you get the picture. She had the right outfit for anything we went to, and she looked just fantastic lying in the seraglio in the afternoon in jeans and a t-shirt reading Jane Austen. She apparently disdained water sports. We never saw her in a bathing suit. She was a smackhead, of course. You could tell that right away. All those European kids were then. But she never did it in public. She never shared. She would just get all winsome and content and dozy, and you could tell. We never asked her. She never did cocaine with us after dinner, just sipped her white wine and looked far, far into the future. She was probably 23, so there was a lot of future to look into. The women liked her because she posed no threat whatsoever to anybody, and the men liked her because she was like a little parakeet with beautiful plumage. You could have sit on the tip of your index finger and just stare at it, just for the pleasure of the colors and the loveliness of life beating in her little chest. We called her Jules, and like any good pet, she came when she was called, and like some pets, you could possess her for a while, but she'd let you know you could never really own her, not really, like a cat, like a fish, like a bird on your finger. She had a sweetly vague continental accent, unlike most of the girls who hung around that summer, and she actually had a job, not that she got paid. In fact, she paid to do it. She was in New York for the summer, studying art restoration with this tiny little man on Green Street, the ogre, she called him, and together they were working on restoring the largest Titian in the world, still in private hands. She seemed to know a lot about art. The rest of us in general knew nothing about art, besides your basic art history 101 kind of stuff, although we went to galleries like Castelli and Mary Boone and spent enormous sums on the latest and coolest decorations, now mostly in warehouses, I assume. Mine are long gone, I know that, 10 cents on the dollar. The funny thing is, I can't remember one witty thing she said all summer. She wasn't funny or clever in that way, not one remark. She never even tried, just stared at you with her calm and tender expression and smiled like La Gioconda or somebody, only she knew about. She didn't fit in, of course, maybe that was part of the charm. She could play the piano, anything from Bach to Hey Jude, and some nights when we weren't too wrecked, or came home early from a boring party, she'd play for us and we'd stand around the piano singing. Most of us were terrible except for Finelli, who had a real sweetness in his voice, a clarity and kindness that embarrassed even him. But if you could get him to sing, you went to bed feeling life was a pretty good thing after all. I know we all wondered what she did lying there in the nights, listening to the howling storms of sex all around her, smelling the smells, feeling the vibrations, lying in her virginal bed and her immaculate sheets. She probably just nodded off, nodded at, but she must have been aware. It was what the house was about, all those rutting nights, and she must have been aware. But she'd appear at breakfast in time to do the dishes, and she never complained about the slightest thing, and there was a serenity about her that defied any but pharmaceutical explanations. The maid came every day during the weeks, and the house was immaculate every weekend, but Jules made sure we left it the way we found it. We never broke a single thing that whole summer, not a glass. She said dishes had to be washed and dried by hand. She said dishwashers left a film of soap on everything, and that wasn't kind to the next guest. She loved doing dishes, and we stood around her like puppies, drying them and putting them away while the women smoked and glared. Dishwashing time took away from drinking champagne and doing coke, and they tapped their feet impatiently until the last dish was put away. And then one weekend she died. Hummingbirds' hearts beat so fast that if they stop to rest or sleep, their hearts slow down, and sometimes they can't get them to get up to speed again, so they die without ever waking up. I found her. She didn't show up for breakfast, which wasn't unusual, and she missed the narcissistic hour by the pool and the tennis that she never went to anyway, and when we came home, we assumed she'd gone to the beach or for a walk, or just didn't feel like it that Saturday. It wasn't until the wearing blender had started up that we thought to look in her room. I knocked softly, a little harder, and then turned the handle. She was lying in her perfect sheets, and there was blood coming from her nose and her mouth. There was vomit on her ruined silk nightgown. By her hand, there were open glassine envelopes of heroin with powder spilling on the sheets. By the bed on the nightstand, there was an empty bottle of Seconal. There was no note. I didn't know what to do. I didn't cry, I didn't call out, I just watched her. The soft lids closed over her azure eyes. I took a cloth and cleaned the blood from her face. I used warm water, knowing it wouldn't make any difference to Julia. Her skin was so cold, and underneath the blood she was as sweet and unfazed as ever. Even death hadn't surprised her. I touched her face, I kissed her icy cheek. It was the only time I ever touched her. Then I went into the kitchen and told the others. The blender stopped. We agreed to clean the house of any drugs before we called 911, so each of us went to our rooms and brought down whatever we had. We put it all in a big trash bag, and Finelli drove it down to Sagmain Beach and buried it in the sand with an old tire over the spot so we could go back and get it. Then we made the call. They came in seconds. The rest is a blur. The rest is just the same details as anybody else's death. There were questions, of course. There was a search of the house. Everything was in order. We let the barbecue burn out while we sat and drank hard liquor. We went out to dinner and ate in silence. Then we drove back to the beach at midnight to retrieve the drugs. Funny thing, a lot of people didn't want to claim what was theirs. We sat there with a counter full of drugs that seemed to have no answers. Finelli sang a quiet, tiny song. It was in Italian. Then I sat up very late and got very drunk and did drugs all by myself until the sky was blue. That was the first week in August. It happened on my birthday. I went to the funeral. We all went. Turned out her father was a French count who was tiny and ugly. He had a gigantic art collection, one of the most important in the world. Museums were already fighting over it. Her mother was dead, but her stepmother was a Spanish knockout who had been an airline stewardess. I didn't speak to them. The coffin was open. She was perfect, calm and lovely, in a simple embroidered cotton nightgown. She was a countess, and she was finally the prettiest girl in the room. You say to yourself, she wasn't the kind. She wasn't the kind to do that. But there was the empty bottle of Seconal. She knew what she was doing. It was time for her to leave the party where she never really met anybody. For though many asked her to dance, there was no Prince Charming. There was an article about it in the Weekly Rag, the death of a countess kind of article. Here's what happens to careless international trash in the Hamptons kind of article. And that's how I know that part about the airline stewardess thing. Apparently she was a big deal back in France. She was, according to the article, the kind of girl who knew that tiaras weren't just pinned to your head, they were woven into your hair. It took hours and it hurt like hell. She was the kind of girl who was going to marry a king if one could be found. She was just slumming with us. She was trying not to be who she was for a little while, drinking cold Montrachet, dreaming with Jane Austen on her lap, in a Moroccan tent, and removing tiny smudges of grime from a Titian that happened to belong to her father. I refused to talk to the reporters. I said I didn't know who she was. I couldn't tell them a thing about her. I couldn't tell them about the blood on her face or the vomit on her nightgown. We had 3 weeks left in the house, and we drank blender drinks and lay in the seraglio in the cool evenings and drank cold Dom Perignon and did cocaine and laughed and had people over for barbecues, but it was never the same. I was drunk every minute of every day, all weekend, every weekend. Even Finelli was drunk and sad all the time. It wasn't creepy, but the bubble had gone out of the champagne. We skipped the last weekend, Labor Day. We got there Friday night and left Saturday morning. We just didn't feel like it. I left the tent where it was, let somebody else deal with it. The summer had cost me almost $200,000. 3 months later, I was in rehab again, this time for the last time. One day I came back from lunch, 3 martinis and big slabs of rare roast beef and raw cocaine under my belt, and I stood and waited for the elevator. The doors opened, a voice clearly said to me, "Don't get on that elevator. If you do, you will die." The doors closed, all the happy bees going back to the hive, and I went home. They were very understanding. The personnel women called me, and I hadn't bathed or shaved in 6 days, and I broke down on the phone, blubbered like a baby about my lost ways, and she offered to have me sent to rehab, and I packed in my sweats. And I went, leaving 28 days later, so clean and sober it hurt, and filled with boredom and self-loathing. Then they fired me. I never even went back to get my check. Once you leave the street, you don't go back, not even to buy a hot dog from the soubrettes man on the corner. And then the phone rings less and less, and eventually Finelli was the last one to call and say one more time how sorry he was and what a great summer he was, except for, well, you know, the thing. And that we really should get together one of these days. And I never went and wrote my phone number on a girl's tits again. Little by little, you lose it all until you're left with a pure electric shock of the sober life. A life without friends, without money, without trainers at the gym, without countesses who die while under your watch. And no, 6 months later, I was broke. 9 months later, I was selling running shoes at Paragon. I worked a series of jobs. I started drinking again, but never in public. The trouble with drinking in public is, one, the glasses aren't big enough. Two, somebody uglier and drunker than you is always hitting on you. And three, there's no place to lie down. The other night, I was coming back from a bookstore where I eventually ended up working. Now I'm the supervisor of the ordinary clerks, and the two girls at the checkout counter were talking, and one was showing off her new bracelet to the other girl, and she said, "Girl, I mean, ain't this bracelet bad? Like, ain't it just so bad?" And the other girl, bagging my pork chops and broccoli, said, "Girl, it's so bad, it's fatal." Well, it's all fatal, isn't it, in the end? I look at my Christmas tree. It's kind of short and scrawny, the way my life is lived now. It suits me. But the ornaments are miraculous, collected over the years when I got a yard and a half 2 weeks before Christmas. Boats and tigers and Buddhas and Santas and satin and ruby slippers, mouth blown in Czechoslovakia when there was one. Dozens of them, thousands of dollars. The ornaments are all the girls who came that summer, the mirrors on the tent, the grams of coke. Almost every night when I'm lying in bed, I hear an ornament fall and break. They break because there are no presents under the tree to cushion the fall, only bare wood floor. I come home from work and there is shattered glass everywhere, every day. My ornamented life is fading and I don't really miss it until the swan. This morning, Christmas morning, A beautiful pearl-white swan had fallen and was shattered on the floor. I hadn't even heard it in fall in the night, and I knew it was Julia. The image of her, so swan-like, came back to me as clear as crystal. The sound of her voice, the sweet smell of her nightgown in the morning, the Titian, and her stewardess, wicked stepmother, also dead now, the shining Titian, now in the Prado in Madrid. Like the swans, Jules was an ornament in a life I no longer have and don't miss. But as I swept up the pieces, she cried out to me not to go, not to be thrown away, not to lie in pieces in the garbage with the rest of the detritus of my life. And one more time, I couldn't help her. I just couldn't help her. Thank you.
I forgot to mention that if you haven't gotten a copy of the book, we have plenty up front, so don't be shy. And if you have a question and could make your way to a mic, that would be terrific.
Yes.
Could you can you go to the ma'am? Could you go to the microphone?
Sorry.
Thank you.
There's one right there.
I'm tall enough.
You can just tip it down. Here, I can help.
Sorry.
You. There you go.
Robbie, who was your sixth grade teacher? I knew that would get a smile.
My sixth grade teacher.
Uh-huh. Your sixth grade teacher.
Are you she?
I am she.
Wow.
How are you?
How are you?
Irene Johnson, of course you are.
Yes.
How are you? Great
I'm
to
fine.
See you.
How are you?
I'm fine. I'm fine, as it happens.
Okay.
I'm fine. This is Irene Johnson, my sixth grade teacher.
That Robbie, I'm using a very familiar term.
Yes, you are. But everybody else uses
wrote
it too.
Essays and read the Encyclopedia Britannica the whole class time. I'm going to show you something.
And she allowed me to do it.
What?
And you allowed me to do it.
Well, you were so quiet, I didn't.
Anybody else?
Other questions? I'll ask a question while these shy people get their courage up to come up to the microphone. You've written a memoir, obviously nonfiction, and I believe I read someplace or heard you speak about this new book and mentioned that there are elements of autobiography in it. And I'm just wondering, how do you manage the autobiographical aspects of writing? And what's the difference between doing it, the obvious difference between fiction and nonfiction, but were there ways in which you tried to use your own autobiographical material in a fictional sense that was more liberating, or just what was the difference?
Well, it is autobiographical, this book, but it's great when you don't have to tell the truth.
that was kind of what I was getting at.
Heading Out to Wonderful, my last novel, the first sentence is, the thing is, all memory is fiction. And I do believe that, but I also think that all fiction is autobiography. The French have a particular genre that they call autofiction. And it's novels that are true. From the writer's point of view, Emmanuel Carrère is a great practitioner of this. It's the writer writing about, and that Swedish guy who's now written the 8,000-page book that everybody's so wild about. Mm-hmm. That is autofiction. I mean, it's writing about your own life, but through a lens of fiction, so that you're not bound to tell the absolute photographic truth. This book, I took people I knew, I called them by other names, I took things that happened, I transposed them from New York to Las Vegas, I took things that happened in Las Vegas and transposed them to, wherever. It is really a kaleidoscope of people and places that happened to me in my youth, it is as Wordsworth said, passion recollected in tranquility. And that is the difference, I think, to answer the obvious question. It's the difference between The Fall of Princes and, say, Bright Lights, Big City. Mm-hmm. Bright Lights, Big City was written at the time and was part of the era. This is a recollection of the time 30 years later and is recollected in tranquility and is a transposition of the era as opposed to being a piece of the, a part of it. Mm-hmm. You know, McInerney's book is, you know, is in that time capsule. This book is not. Which is not to say it's better or worse, it's just that it does a different thing. It's much more, I felt a greater freedom. Even though I would say that, you know, all these people in the book are real to me, but whether they're real people is hard to say.
Yeah, it's a good distinction. That's interesting.
Yes.
Is everybody in this book a narcissist? I have a friend who a cousin and his wife work in the city in London, and all they can do is talk about their adventures in London, and all she can think of is why aren't they in jail?
Well, I think New Yorkers tend to be narcissistic. New Yorkers are great complainers. And the 80s were a very narcissistic age. I think we were young, we had money for the first time. We were having more fun than was legal. And we loved it. We loved ourselves for having the life we had. We were thrilled with it. So if that's narcissism, I guess we were narcissistic, but it's also just youthful exuberance, you know? I don't think we were particularly arrogant about it. I just think that we really enjoyed our lives.
Still seems to be the way they conduct themselves.
And then the gate slammed shut very quickly in the 80s. So it ended with a bang. Londoners, I don't know. I mean, I don't know how they afford to be narcissistic. With, you know, roast chickens costing £36, I don't know how they afford to be narcissistic.
Well, that's her opinion of her relatives, too. They can't afford the way they
right.
Are.
Anybody else? Yes?
Does everybody outgrow this kind of brittle life? I mean, aren't there still people who live like this with silly money and...
Absolutely.
Is it necessary to outgrow?
Ralph Lauren and his wife wanted a marble floor for their house in Bedford, Connecticut. And so they flew to Carrara and they chose the marble and they had the floor cut. And Ricky, Ralph Lauren's wife, I read this in the paper, this is not inside knowledge. Ralph Lauren's wife, Ricky, wanted it right away, so she had it FedExed from Italy to Bedford, Connecticut, and had it put down. And then she didn't like it, so she had it taken up and FedExed back to Italy. So this, for some people, the party never ends. So yes, but I think most people, you marry, you have children, you move to the suburbs, and in terms of the 80s, and this is very much what the book is about, the AIDS crisis hit and changed everything. Suddenly the people who were dancing were dying, and it changed everything overnight, almost overnight. And it was a terrible, terrible, horrible tragedy. And so life wasn't so much fun anymore. You know, when you spent, you know, instead of flying to Beverly Hills to go to a birthday party, you were going to funerals 4 days a week. It didn't seem quite so much fun. Anybody else?
It's hard to get to a microphone. The hedonism in your book seems really real. Is the remorse as valid and as legitimate?
Oh, yeah, and it's longer lasting, too.
Yeah, do you feel it as much? Still. I mean, which do you, I don't know, treasure is probably the wrong word, but which one lasts with you longer?
I don't know. I think it would be wrong to regret forever things you did as a child. I mean, we were children. We were really children. And I think it would be wrong to regret it forever. But still, it does color your life. You know, there's certain things that you remember, that I remember, that still cause a twinge when I think of them. And there is a certain, I think, this happens when you grow older. There's a certain sense of loss that stays with you. And it's the loss of youth, and it's the loss of beauty, and it's the loss of lots of things. Freedom. I'm sure people who marry and have children, although they get joy out of their children, there is nevertheless a sense of loss of freedom that never goes away. And the same is true for people who don't have children. You know, you miss your youth. You miss it, you know. And no matter how current you remain or how much your love of music or art or whatever stays contemporary, you're still 60 years old, you know. You're not 30 anymore. So. Yes.
Hello, Robert. How are you?
Hi.
Wordsworth actually writes about that rather eloquently, the loss of youth. I can understand you being able to write about this time period because you lived it, but I was a very big fan of A Reliable Wife.
Yes.
And I was really interested to try to understand how you transported yourself back to that time period and wrote about that genre. I wasn't sure whether you had the idea and tried to fit that genre into that time period or whether it was the other way around.
In Reliable Wife, I had this picture of a woman standing alone in a garden. And in this image, the garden came back to life. And from that, I slowly sort of developed the story. And the story depended on the two of them being isolated. I wanted them to be isolated geographically so that whatever happened between them had to happen one on one. I didn't want them to be involved in some larger, like Dickensian social network, you know? And so once I decided to isolate them geographically, I wanted to isolate them in time as well. When I started the book, it was a contemporary book. It took place in the present. And I didn't get very far before I realized it just didn't work. Because he could Google her, he could look her up on Facebook, he could, you know. We're too easy to trace. And I just picked 1907 at random. And then I wanted them to be isolated geographically, and so I thought, what's the bleakest place I've ever been? And I thought, I used to do the advertising for Kohler, which is in northern Wisconsin. And we almost always had to go there somehow in January. So I thought that is the bleakest place I've ever been. So I settled in northern Wisconsin. It was kind of accidental, and it was a kind of chain of events that happened that made it turn out the way it did. It was a very lucky and fruitful accidental chain of events that led me to that. And then I remembered, because it was 1907, I remembered that I had loved Michael Lesy's Wisconsin Death Trip, out of which a great deal of the kind of background of that book came. And then I thought, well, she has to come from somewhere. And I had once worked on a movie with a friend of mine, Paul Schrader, and the movie was set in St. Louis. And so it happened that I had in my closet, I wrote to the St. Louis Chamber of Commerce when we were working on this movie and said, do you have any information on St. Louis at the turn of the century? And they sent me this huge box of stuff. So I thought, oh, she could come from St. Louis. So I went and dragged the box out of the... So it was all accidental, but it was a very happy accident, I must say, in retrospect. And thank you.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Yes, sir.
Mr. Goolrick, I understand you said in the past how you want to encourage writers to take risks. So what do you think the biggest risk was you took writing this thing, and do you think it paid off?
Because my heart is in this book.
Give me
my heart is in every book. I don't write to disguise myself. I write to reveal myself. And I write to communicate something about myself that I can't say in any other way. I think writers are, well, no, I don't know about writers. I think that I'm basically born mute. And that I cannot speak of my feelings about myself. I can speak more about my feelings about you than I can about myself. And writing books is the only way I've found to speak about myself, but I have to speak in this very disguised way. And so these books are kind of like veiled self-portraits. So I make these self-portraits and I leave it up to you to find me in them. And and what was the second part about other writers?
I wondered if you thought it paid off the risk. If you know the book, you'd be like, damn, that risk was worth it.
Well, I know in my memoir, from the letters I've gotten from people who say, I've never told this to anybody.
I've seen it in the memoir. I'm just curious about this one.
Oh, this book. Well, we'll see, won't we? I mean, I don't know yet. It certainly has in my own heart, it's paid off. In that I think I said I love you in a way that I was never able to say it in real life. Whether it's heard or not is not my business.
I was wondering, with your vast knowledge of the wacko world of advertising and its excesses, why you would choose to do the financial industry? Why would you choose those young men?
Well, for one thing, I think that in the 80s, Wall Street was truly the zeitgeist of the age. You know, advertising was sort of the bastard stepchild of the zeitgeist of the age. We lived as though we were Wall Streeters, but we really weren't. And, but if you look at the people who really control the culture, I didn't feel that and also I think to have raked over those coals for me would have been tiresome, I think. It's the same reason I didn't watch Mad Men, you know, when it was on television. It would be like a psychiatrist watching a program about psychiatrists, you know. I just don't think there's a lot of interest there. And I don't, you know, I always wanted to write a book about a pitch. A pitch, and do you know what a pitch is in advertising? It's when two advertising agencies vie for a new account. I always thought that would make an interesting subject for a sort of thriller book. And I work it all out in my mind, but somehow the fingers don't hit the keyboard. You just don't get going.
I'm just going to ask, does anybody else have a question? And if not, I will ask the last question. Or do you have a question, sir? No? Just getting back to what you were saying prior to your question. So when you were writing this book And you said it was sort of a love letter in a way to yourself, or a feeling of being able to say that you know, I love you to yourself. Is that...
No, sorry? It was a way of saying I love you to somebody else.
Oh, to somebody else, okay. In any case, is the process of writing this, is it sort of catharsis, or is it reconciliation?
It's healing.
It's healing, okay. Interesting. And can you just describe lastly for us just what your writing process is? Do you have a set way of doing things? Do you have a set routine?
Well, it's sort of like Russian roulette. If I get up in the morning and start writing right away, then I have a writing day. If I get up in the morning and do a load of laundry, the day's shot. It literally is. I'll never start writing if I go to town and get a dozen lemons before I start writing.
But that doesn't interrupt the completion of the
process. If I start writing, then I can stop and do a load of laundry and then go on. But if I do something first, it somehow... the computer just sits there like an alien being and glares at me all day long and plays Pandora and says, go away.
This is probably very reassuring to anybody out there who's ever tried to write a novel.
I know. It's not quite like writer's block. It's like writer's... It's like my computer is actually feeling animosity toward me.
Well... congratulations on getting the book done in that case. And we will have to end it now. But as I said, there are plenty of books up front, and Mr. Goolrick would be happy to sign up here. And if you don't mind putting your chairs to the side, we would be grateful. And thank you all so much for coming.
Let me say one more time, I'm deeply honored to be here. And thank you all for coming.
We are deeply honored to have you. Thank you for coming.